How's it going, guys? Pesh Cats here, and today we are going to be looking at another week's worth of Card of the Day previews for Kantai Collection 3. So let's just get right into it. So first we're going to be taking a look at Sunday's previews with some Germans. We have Prinz Eugen, level 1. So she is a 1-0-45, and she has a climax combo with the Stalk Soul Climax. On attack, if you have at least one other green character, you can pay one, search your deck for a ship girl character, add it to your hand, and then she gets plus 2000 until the end of the opponent's turn. So this is kind of interesting in that, like, Bushiroad hasn't been really releasing a lot of, like, pay one search cards. It's been a lot of on reverse search. Like, you look at a lot of or just on reverse plus, you look at a lot of the sets that have come out recently, and they all have, like, on reverse plus cards that don't require any stock. So decks like Monogatari, they got the 1-0 Shinobu, Schoolgirl Strikers has Satoka, like Idolmaster, of course you have Minami, just like a whole bunch of sets where like their abilities are on reverse. And so I can only think of like three cards recently where it's pay one on attack to like get a card. And like just off the top of my head, like literally right now. So I can think of like Rika from Idolmaster Cinderella, and that only works with yellow, so like it doesn't work with the entire set. So probably not as good of a card as the Prinz. I can think of Yuki from Sao, and I can think of, holy crap, I can't even think of a third one. I guess like the blue and red climax combo from Girlfriend Beta, where you just like, it's on attack, you pay one and you search. So like there's really not a lot of paying climax combos being released right now. So just kind of interesting. Figured I'd note that. So anyways, the details about this card. So you don't have to reverse, obviously, because you're paying one on attack. In comparison to on reverse climax combos, you do have to pay stock, but because the climax combo is a stock soul, the first one's effectively free, but you're going to want to have multiple copies of the Prinz in order to actually plus in card advantage, because the first Prinz that you play, the first Prinz combo that you use, it's just going to replace the climax, and then any further ones beyond that are the ones that are going to plus you. Now, on the bright side, you are going to be like plus 2k until the end of your opponent's turn. So she's going to be a 6-5 before assist. So it's going to be a lot easier for you to defend her. And if you have multiple Stalk Soul Climax combo or climaxes in your hand, then you can potentially keep your princes alive and then get more value out of playing climax combo multiple turns in a row. You need another green character, which is really not going to be hard to do. Just like play multiple princes or like having a Kotsky on your field or something like that. As for the price, it's kind of, like I said, there's not a lot of plus on attack climax combos, like where you pay stock, that are coming out right now. The probably the closest one I can think of is like Yuki, because Rika, because it only searches yellow characters and requires a full field of yellow, like it has a really low price tag, like 200 yen right now. So I don't think that's really comparable in the same way. So I would say like the closest card's like Yuki from Sword Art Online. And that card's like $8, and but that's like a rare and extra booster, and this is a double R in a main booster. So like, it's really hard to just come up with something that I can directly compare this to in order to come up with like a price range. But just as like a rough guess, I'm gonna predict around 900 yen. So yeah, there you go. Moving on to the next Prinz, we have Prinz Eugen Kai, which is a ship girl heavy cruiser. 3-2-10k. When you play her, you can take the Prinz level 1 from your waiting room and put it under her as a marker. When she attacks, if she has a marker, she gets 1,000 times the opponent's cost until the end of the turn. So if she's fighting against a level 0, she's not going to gain any power. If she's fighting against like a 2-1, she gets 1,000 power. And if she's fighting against a 3-2, then she gets 2,000 power. Not exactly the biggest boost, but I mean, like, she gets a boost. All right, let's not complain. And her last effect is a restand ability. During the turn, she's placed onto the stage from your hand. If she reverses a battle opponent, you can pay 3 and discard a card in order to restand. So, very, very generic set of abilities. you're obviously going to want to run the 1-0 in the same deck as this one so that you can even get the marker in the first place, so you can get the power. And the 1-0, like, it's a decent card on its own. So, like, there's no reason that you could, like, run this without the 1-0. So just run the 1-0. As for the actual, like, restand ability, because she only reaches 12k by herself, it might be kind of hard to, like, kill some of the higher level 3s, especially if your opponent's playing some counters that can be used to just get over this. As an Honorverse standard, it's weak to anti-change, of course. If you're planning on playing this with a Climax, like, one of your Climaxes in the deck is going to be a Stoxel because you're running the 1-0, so that's not going to be giving this any power, so just keep that in mind. And, yeah, the cost is pretty high. You have to pay 3 and discard 1 for a restand, so playing multiple copies of this is kind of unrealistic. Honestly, I could see just the 1-0 Prinz being played without this, and you could just play something else at level 3. Like, there's a lot of other cards that you could be playing at level 3 that aren't this Prinz. It doesn't even replace itself when you play it. It doesn't cantrip, so it doesn't, like, supplement its own discard cost for the restand. Alright, moving on. Next up, moving on to Monday's previews, we have Graf Zeppelin Kai. So this is a ship girl and aircraft carrier. So she has an assist 2000 to level 3 or higher characters in front of her. So you can use this to help out with the Prinz Eugen restander. Give her another 2k power so she can potentially reach up to 14k. Her second ability is pay to tap her to clock swap. Take a card from your clock, put it in your hand. Take the top card of your deck, put it into clock. So it's kind of whatever. You're not going to really be using the second ability as much. You should probably be getting, like, all your searching and stuff out of the way with, like, your level 1 combos or, like, just other abilities. Like, there's... You have Akatsuki. You're Kantai. You have Akatsuki. You have tons of ways to get the cards that you want to get. So this second ability, not really that relevant. First ability, the 2k can help out. But I would probably run other supports over this. This card's just whatever. Next card. We have Jinsu. Festival Jinsu Kaini. This is one of my favorite new cards that was revealed this week. I love this card. So it's a 002k, ship girl, and light cruiser. When you play it, you can clock the top card of your deck and discard a card to search your deck for a climax. So you can use this to search your climax for your level 1 combo. Like, oh crap, I opened the wrong climax. Play Jinsu, pitch it, search your deck for the right climax, and then you have your climax combo. Now, because it's not like a Ricky or Inazuma, it's kind of comparable because you're clocking yourself to do something, but you're not actually gaining any card advantage. So for that reason, you're going to want to be, like, ideally you're using this with a combo that lets you plus in card advantage, so something like the Prinz. Or if you have Amagi, then you can use this with the Amagi, and then you plus. So this card just helps you get the climaxes that you need for your game plan, and just helps your deck run more smoothly. Personally, I think as far as ratios go, I would probably run, like, two of this and two Inazumas in just, like, any deck. I think you can bring down the number of Inazumas just because you have a lot of other cards that can get you the characters you need, things like Akatsuki. So Inazuma, really not as necessary. And searching a climax is a lot more important, in my opinion. Now, the card is a discard outlet, so, like, if you have, like, a really shitty hand early game, or, like, if you have Vernie, you have Vernie in your hand, you want to pitch that, set up for Hibiki, so you can do the bonds, anti-heal play, get a 1-0. So you can use that, get the Vernie into waiting room, even though you already have things like Akatsuki that can do the same thing. But, like, yeah, whatever. Now, the fact that it takes a climax out of your deck, it's going to make your compression worse, obviously. You're going to be more susceptible to taking damage. So, if you have other abilities like Amagi, Akatsuki, or even Drum Barrel with Harasame, that can help you go through your deck and make it so that your less than ideal deck compression isn't so much of a problem, then that could be a good thing to play with this card. Now, Amagi and Akatsuki both already extremely good cards, and you would probably run them in pretty much any Kantai deck as it is, so it shouldn't be too much of a problem. And of course, this doesn't have an SR version, so I can't play that great, great damage art. Feels bad, man. Hold on, I'm gonna turn on the light, because it's kind of dark. Here, hold on one sec. Alright. The room will light up a bit more as the video keeps going. But anyways, let's move on to the next card. I do like this card a lot, by the way. And it's an uncommon. Why is this an uncommon? Everyone's like, this should be a rare or something. But hey, it's uncommon. It's gonna be cheaper for me to get. Cool stuff. Alright, let's see. Next card is Akatsuki Kaini, aka the Elephant Lady herself. So, she falls into like an archetype of cards that is coming out in Kantai 3 that's specifically supporting a Destroyer deck. So, you guys didn't see it in last week's previews because I didn't put it in, but Fubuki Kaini is a level 3 Destroyer, and it's double R. And it's intended to be a finisher to be used in the Destroyer deck because she burns based on the number of Destroyers you have. So, anyways, Akatsuki fits into the whole Destroyer theme. So she's a 2-1, 6K. She gains 1,000 for every other Destroyer you have on the stage. So with a full field of Destroyers, you become a 10K. And her second ability is an activate, pay 1, give a Destroyer 1,500 until the end of the turn. And she can give it to herself. So potentially just like stock outlet, pay out a bunch of stock, gain a bunch of power, kill a bunch of stuff. Now, as far as how good an all-Destroyer deck is going to be, I can't really say yet because we have only seen, like, five Destroyer-based cards so far in this set. We've seen, like, Fubuki Kaini, Isokaze, Murasame Counter, this card, and Kawakaze Level 0, which was leaked in the trailer video, which I can talk about that later. But anyways, I can't really say how good an all Destroyer deck is going to be. I mean, like, you could just, like, slap all the plus two soul abilities together into a single deck. Like, just play, like, Ayanami and Akatsuki and play Yukikaze so that you can continually get a Destroyer back in your hand every turn with her pay one to, like, put her back in your hand ability. So, I mean, there's already decent enough Destroyers that you can play, but as far as, like, a full deck type of Destroyers, I honestly don't know how good it's going to be yet. So, I can't really judge the card. It's a 2-1 10k if you are going to be playing the Destroyer deck. So, I mean, like, whatever. And it's an uncommon. So, I mean, like, it's not going to take up... This card's not taking up a rare slot. You don't need to worry about, like, oh, shit, I pulled this, and it could have been a good rare. So, yeah. Now, moving on to a card that is a rare, we have Taiho. So, you guys remember from the trailer video, as well as last week, I said the 3-2 early drop was Taiho Kai. And we would probably be seeing a regular Taiho coming out. And so here she is. So she's basically Kirito from the Gun Gale Online trial deck, except instead of a stock soul, she combos with a wind. So climax combo when she reverses an opponent, search your deck for a ship girl. Very, very simple. 1/1/6/5. So she's basically a Shimakaze with a stock cost in that she's a 1/1/6/5. Because she has a 6/5 base power, it's going to be higher. It's going to be easier for you to defend her from your opponent's characters. Like Shimakaze, she's 5k. Like, that's gonna die extremely easily to your opponent's characters. At the same time, because she's a 1-1, and the climax isn't a stock soul like Kirito, you're gonna be investing a lot more stock in order to, you know, use the Taiho. So, like, playing multiple copies of this Taiho is kind of unrealistic. You're gonna be paying a lot of stock early game. And it's even more unrealistic to, like, try to use this card with Amagi. Like, honestly, I would probably just play, like one Taiho and one Amagi. And then just, like, click Climax. Like, it's whatever. Because the Climax is a wind and not a stock cell, though, it's gonna make you higher in power offensively, which is gonna make it easier for you to kill your opponent's cards. So, I mean, this card's alright. It's a 1-1 plussing climax combo. The fact that the climax doesn't replace itself in the same way that Shimakaze's does, because Shimakaze has a 2k1, it's going to immediately replace itself when you play it. So anything that Shimakaze kills, you're automatically plussing. Because the climax doesn't replace itself, you're going to need two or more Taihos in order to actually make it a plus. Because the first Taiho, you're just replacing the climax. Any subsequent Taihos, then you're plussing. So Taiho... it's alright. I honestly don't think it's going to see much, if any, play. Maybe as like a budget option. Like, if you can't afford Shimakazes, you can like try picking up Taiho. They're in the same color. They're both on reverse combos. This one comes with the added bonus of it being a win, so you can bounce like your opponent's annoying stuff. Like, it's okay. All right. I honestly think Shimakaze is better, but even better than Shimakaze, I think Prinz is probably a better choice. So, yeah. All right, moving on to this was yesterday's previews. Yeah, Taiho was on Tuesday, so this is Wednesday. We have Roma getting into the Italians. So the Italians are all blue. You guys saw Italia / Littorio in last week's previews. So now we're moving on to Roma. So she's a 2/1/7/5 ship girl and battleship trait. When you play her, she gets 500 times the number of ship girls on your stage until the end of the turn. This includes herself, so if you play her on a full board, she becomes a 10k. And her second ability is a climax combo. When you play the book climax, you can send her to waiting room to play the 3/2 Roma from your hand to the stage, which we'll get to in a sec. So take a look at some of the details I have here. So the two abilities like cover for each other. If you do have the climax and you have the 3/2 in your hand, you can play the climax combo, get the 3/2 onto the board, and then you have a 3/2. If you don't have the climax combo, all the pieces together, then you play her, she gets power buff until the end of the turn. Because if you play her for the power buff, then you're immediately taking her off the field. That wouldn't make any sense. So like either situation, you're basically covered. The climax art's very good. I like Roma as a ship, so this climax makes me happy, especially compared to like climax arts like Bismarck, because people are still triggered. Okay, anyways, moving on now to the 3/2, since this card lets you bring the 3/2 Roma into play, so we got to talk about that next. So here we have Roma Kai. So 3/2 10k, when she comes into play from your hand, search your deck for up to one ship girl and add it to your hand. This does trigger off of the 2/1 climax combo, because the 3/2 Roma is coming from your hand to the stage. So when Roma sacks itself, bring out the 3/2, you'll be able to search your deck for any ship girl. And second ability, at the start of the opponent's attack phase, you can discard a card, and then Roma Kai gets 3k power and -1 level until the end of the opponent's turn. So the cool thing about this is you can loop the 2/1 combo. If you have, let's say you have three of the 2/1 on your field, and you only have one copy of the 3/2, and you have the book. So you play the book, you sack one of the 2/1s, you play the 3/2 from your hand. Now her ability primes because she was placed on the stage from your hand. You resolve her first, search your deck for another 3/2 Roma. Now you sack another 2/1, play a 3/2, use her effect, search another 3/2, sack the last 2/1, play another 3/2, search for any ship girl. That makes sense. So you can loop it so that you can play multiple 3/2s onto your board, even though you only had one in your hand, because her ability allows you to search your deck for another ship girl. Now, her second ability is designed to protect her from anti-change abilities on the opponent's turn. Now, on your turn, you're still weak to like getting anti-change countered. Like, they can just play like a sac counter, kill your Roma. But like, if you have multiple copies, then like, that's like kind of okay, I guess, because they all replace themselves anyway, even though you're sacking the 2/1. But honestly, anti-change on your own turn should not be a problem. You have a book climax in play. You should easily be able to just like side with all these Romas, still deal like 2-3 damage for each attack. Like, that should not be a problem. So the design of this card is that going into the opponent's turn, if they have an anti-change suicider, like Abukuma Kaini, which we'll get to later, that was today's preview, then this ability is designed to prevent that from killing her. You discard a card, she loses a level so that your opponent can't use an anti-change effect on her, or they can't use an effect like an anti-level 3 burst attacker. So like cards like 2/1 Inori or Katori from Guilty Crown and Love Live. When this card attacks, if your opponent has a level 3 character across from this gets 6,000 power. So you use this effect at the start of your opponent's attack phase, shut that down so they can't kill your Roma. So it's designed completely to be an early play and then just sit there on the board. It doesn't have really any value from staying on the board longer. Like, it doesn't have like a top check scry ability with like cards like 3-2 Ami from Idolmaster or 3-2 Shinobu from Monogatari. It's designed to just be a two soul attacker that sticks there on the board that your opponent hopefully can't get rid of. So there you go. That's basically it. And it's an uncommon, low rarity. All of these Roma cards are very low rarity. So if you're looking for a low budget option, you can definitely look into Roma Kai as one of those options, because I think this card is, it's not spectacular. It's really not, but it's not terrible at the same time. And because it fits into blue, you can use it with blue cards that don't really like try to use climax combos at like level one. Like, cause like blue, you have cards like Taige, Akashi. You can just like play the beater game until you hit level two and then you play these. So, and then at level three, you can play like Italia, the restand combo. So good stuff. Italy dot deck. Now, unfortunately, we do have one bad card here for the Italians, but we do have one very good level zero. So we have the Halloween Roma. It's a 00-1500. It's a ship girl and a battleship. When you play it, you get to top check, and you can either leave it on the top or put it on the bottom of your deck. And then on attack, if you have one or less other characters on your stage, mill the top card, and if it's a level zero, you get to play it to your back row in any slot for free. So we've seen this kind of ability on three cards before, I think. We've seen it on the Rene level zero Clock Suicider, which hasn't come out yet. Actually, it has come out already, because it's the 15th in Japan right now. Okay, so it has come out. The Rene Clock Suicider from Kyokai no Rene has this on attack mill ability. If it's level zero, you play it to back row. We also have the level zero Cordelia Drop Searcher from Milky Holmes extra booster that just came out, and we have the level zero Momo Suicider from To Love Ru second set. Now, the Halloween Roma, it doesn't have a spectacular second effect like those other three cards do. Like, it's not a suicider and it's not a drop searcher, but at the same time, the top check is going to allow it to set itself up for its own ability. So like, you can check the top card. Is it a level zero? No, bottom deck it. We get a second chance now on attack, mill one. All right, that's a zero, play it. So it's going to be able to set itself up for its own ability, which is really cool. At the same time, the other three, two of the other three, they don't have a way to scale into the late game. Like the drop searcher, you can use that at any stage of the game, but like level zero suiciders, you can't really do that. With this card, the top check is going to be valid at every stage of the game. Like, there's no reason that like you can't just like slap this down, top check, cool, all right, I know what my trigger is, now I can play around that. So Halloween Roma is a spectacular level zero, and I think the main problem with the card is going to be finding a place to use it, because there's so many other spectacular level zeros like Akatsuki, Jinsu, Inazuma, Amagi, like things like that. It's going to be hard to find a place to put this into the deck, but if you can find room, I think it is definitely a very good card. Like, if you play this turn one and you mill an Amagi and you get a free Amagi, like, holy crap, you literally just set yourself up for like your entire like level one climax combo line. You don't even need to search your Amagi anymore. It's the same as like if you play the Cordelia Drop Searcher and then you immediately hit an Ellie level zero, the double R. Like, that's insane. So Halloween Roma, definitely a card that could see play. And I will probably be using this in some of my decks, just because I think the utility is like it's really, really good. You can get free cards at level zero, and you have top checks that scale throughout the game. Now moving on to the other card, Libeccio. This card is freaking trash. This card's awful. Like, I talked in the last episode about the Litoria level zero, the summer one. That card has like double downside. This card also has double downside. So like, this card's like freaking garbage. Like, so it's a 1/0/6/5 ship girl and destroyer. She has two abilities. When this card is on the stage, it gets level minus one, so it becomes a level zero. Dies to level zero suiciders. Like, bad. And then second ability is the character across this gains hand encore. So in a world where like you have cards like Minami, or like, yeah, like Minami's like the perfect example. It has a low base power, but it gains power with its ability. Like when you play a climax, it gets plus 15. That'll allow it to kill this Libeccio. And if this Libeccio kills Minami, and then they hand encore Minami and then just play a climax and then kill Libeccio and then get more pluses. Like, come on, like, why would you do that? Like, this could have easily been 1/0/6/5. This card cannot front attack into characters that are higher level than this, because that is honestly a downside that I don't think is worth plus 1,000. Like, I think that should be worth plus 500. It's not a super detrimental downside compared to this, where you have double downside, and like the card just sucks. Like, all right, moving on. I don't think this card's worth any more of my time. So, all right, moving on to today's previews. We have Akitsushima Kai. This is the third double R for red. So we have Kashima, Fubuki Kaini, and now we have this. So I can assume that this means that we're not getting a second double R in blue at all, because this would make the eighth double R. We have Prinzen Bismarck for green. We have Amagi and Taiho for yellow. And then we have Italia for blue. And then the three red ones, like I mentioned earlier. So anyways, let's get on to what the card does. It's a level 0, 2k, ship girl, and seaplane tender traits. So there aren't a lot of seaplane tender cards in the game. There's only Chiyoda, Chitose, and then Mizuho, if she ever gets a card, and then Akitsushima. So as far as like trait-based abilities go, like, you're not going to see anything involving AVs, like, ever. So continuous. If you have one or less other characters, this gets plus 1500 power. And at the start of the opponent's attack phase, you can move this card to the front row right slot if it's empty. So it's like a run to center, but it's run to right slot. So you compare the closest card I can compare this to right now is like Kaede from IMAS Cinderella Girls set 2. Kaede was, if you meet the condition, she gets plus 1500. So that's just like this card. And then at the start of the opponent's attack phase, she can run to center. Okay, cool. Now, what's cool about this, being able to run to right slot instead of being able to run to center slot, is that it actually makes her safer in the right slot than in the center slot, because a lot of decks right now are running abilities that's like, give 500 power to center. Like, super easy examples, Amagi. Amagi gives 500 power to center. Ellie, also 500 to center. Konoko Brainstorm from Cinderella Girls 2, 500 to center. That makes it harder for the Kaede, because like, if your opponent's giving 500 power to their center, it makes it easier for them to kill your Kaede. But if the Akitsushima is running to the right slot, there aren't cards that like specifically say like, buff the card in your front right slot. So I mean, like, if they run a global 5, sure. If they run a Cis 5, then like, put Akitsushima in the far left slot and make it so that their assist gets like completely screwed up, because they can't cover the left and the right side at the same time. So yeah, that's another way, like, being able to run to the right slot is better than being able to run to center. So I think this card's really cool. Personally, I don't know the flavor behind being able to run to an open right slot. I'm sure there's a reason for this historically, because there are a lot of cards where, like, historically they have like flavor with their cards, but like this one, I don't know off the top of my head. So yeah, anyways, speculated price. Let's talk about the price. I think this will be 1,000 yen when it comes out. Maybe a little bit higher. I really can't say, because Kaede was really hyped when she first came out. She was like 1,500 yen, and then now she's like 500. So I really don't know what to say. But just as my guess, I think she's going to be 1K when she comes out, and then as time goes on, as the level 0 line gets refined, based on whether or not people end up continuing using her, she might stay at 1K, but she might also drop. So I will open up the possibility for her price to go down as time goes on. Next up, we have Akitsushima level 1. This was also revealed in the trailer, but the effect was not clear enough to read. But now we have it as card of the day, so here we go. So this is Akitsushima, ship girl, and seaplane tender. She has a climax combo with Stock Soul. When you play the climax, if this is in your front row, you can pay 1 and then give all of your other characters the following ability until the end of the turn. On attack, reveal the top card of your deck. If it is a ship girl, then salvage 1. If it's not, you just put it back. So the thing about this is that if you play multiple copies of this, then you're potentially getting 2 salvages per 1 stock you pay, because okay, so you give the ability to all your other characters. So you have 2 characters, each of those is going to get a chance to top check. Now the problem with playing multiple copies of this is that So you're stacking the ability on your other character. So if that character attacks, and let's say you stacked multiple Akitsushima abilities onto that character, and you top check a non-ship girl, then you just missed multiple chances to salvage. Personally, I think that the value of this card is best used by just playing one Akitsushima. You're paying one stock, you get two chances. If you miss one, it's not so bad. You pay one stock, you end up paying one stock for one card, and at the same time, her power isn't very good, so she's probably gonna die on your opponent's turn. So I think it's probably best if you just play one Akitsushima and then play like two beaters. Like if you play like red blue level one game, you play like two Taiges or something like that. So yeah. Don't pick Hatsukaze with this card. You're gonna look really stupid. Pick Verny or pick Hibiki or pick Akagi. So yeah. Simple enough card. You pay one stock, you potentially get two cards. If you have multiples, which I don't recommend, you could potentially salvage up to six cards, which is way more than you need, but I mean, whatever. Now for the final preview of the week, we have Abakuma Kaini, which I brought up briefly earlier. So she's an anti-change suicider. Ship girl and light cruiser trait. Her other ability is when she comes into play, mill one. If it's climax, you can burn one. That's cool. I mean, like, it's an anti-change suicider. It has a completely like unrelated ability that could potentially just like burn one damage randomly, and that's perfectly fine. If you're running red, just throw this card into your deck. I mean, it's not like Kantai Collection has any other like really good anti-change abilities, because personally, I think Zuiho is crap. I don't think like, clocking yourself one to anti-change is very good. The fact that she doesn't even sack, it's even worse. So yeah, Abakuma Kaini, pretty decent card. So there we go, guys. That has been all of the card of the day previews for this week. Hope you guys enjoyed. And Kyokai no Rinne is gonna come out right now. And next week is the release of Kantai set 3. So what I'm actually planning to do next week is just do like a big review of all the cards that haven't been revealed already in Card of the Days. And I think what I'll do is I'll do two videos next week, one for next week's Card of the Days, and another video for all the cards that weren't covered. So hope you guys are there to enjoy that with me, and I'll see you guys next week. Bye.